The next best thing, Madonna and Rupert Everett's star at 5 past midnight here on BBC One.
Hello there. There have been over 100 goals in the first round of the Carling Cup, and we've got every one of them for you. Tonight I'm joined by a man who knows all about this competition. He reached the semi-final stage with Sheffield United, Neil Warnock. Neil, great to see you. What's this I hear last night in your 20 years of management was your best first round performance?
Well, you haven't seen some of the performances them over the years. They've been very poor. At this stage of the competition where you play lesser clubs, lower divisions, it's no easy game. And I've had some very poor results and performance over the years, but last night I wanted to play the full team to try and get through. I wanted to have a run this year in the cup, so that's what we did, and it was a good performance.
Okay, well, we'll hear more from Neil and about how his Crystal Palace team got on. Plus, 58 places separate Leicester City and Macclesfield Town, but the team fourth in the Championship won't fancy a trip to the team 14th in League Two. Leicester's winning return to the second tier on Saturday will count for nothing as Nigel Pearson's men take on Keith Alexander's Silkman. It's the focus of our programme tonight. We'll be looking at the two other games being played tonight, including Bradford City travelling to Nottingham Forest, hoping to get that 5-0 drubbing from Notts County out of their system.
Plus, we'll bring you all the action from yesterday's matches, including from Steel City, Sheffield United against Port Vale, Sheffield Wednesday at home to Rochdale, and Rotherham entertaining Derby all on the same night.
Well, the Carling Cup got underway on Monday, of course, when Darlington welcomed Leeds United. Enoch Shawomny's first goal in 8 months was enough to give Leeds United victory in a game of very few chances. It was an emotional return for a man who at one stage feared he might never play again after a blood clot scare. The tall striker got in between Steve Foster and Knight to meet Robert Snodgrass's cross and prod the ball in for his first goal since last December. So let's turn our attentions to Macclesfield against Leicester City. Leicester celebrating their return to the Championship on Saturday, of course, with a win against Swansea. Macclesfield under Keith Alexander, hoping to enjoy a big night against a big-name team. Well, here are the teams. Macclesfield left-back Stephen Reid has been carrying a minor calf strain and doesn't start, but he is on the bench. Reid is joined by on the sidelines by Nat Brown and club captain Sean Hesse. Leicester City are without Alexander Tunchev and Andy King, who are both away on international duty. The Foxes have been given permission to select on-loan Sunderland striker Martin Waghorn in the Carling Cup, and he's on the bench, but full-back Robbie Nielsen is suspended.
Macclesfield Town, who've won just 5 League Cup ties in their entire history, host the 5-time finalists, 3-time winners, Leicester City. Facts which ably demonstrate the gulf in their comparative histories. Leicester boss Nigel Pearson, a former League Cup winner during his playing days with Sheffield Wednesday, also twice a losing finalist with Middlesbrough. Trying to put Grizzly under pressure. Grizzly comes away with it and dwells upon it for too long. Follett again, and now in Gesser. Was it caught by Ben Sharif right on the edge of the area? A free kick in a very promising position for the visitors. Right on the edge of the line. And goes for that side, and Green touches it round. Guarding that particular area, but Adams still fancied guiding it beyond them, and it needed saving, clawed away by Gray. Leicester corner. Howard on the far side, but it's almost hit the corner flag. And he has a wafer-thin squad, Keith Alexander. O'Neill. Nice ball, space for Oakley. Here's Fryer, has a go, hits the back of the defender in front of him, Morgan, spins away for the corner. by Adams. Howard Kane. Slammed in by Oakley and off the line. I think it was Brolland on the far side. And it ends in the arms of Johnny Brain. And Oakley hit it well enough and it was goal-bound. Just the merest of touches off Bolland's foot and onto the post. Adams. Wellens thinks about having a go. Has closed down quickly. Here's O'Neill. Wellens in towards Oakley. Back towards Wellens! Thought it was going in and it arrowed just off target. Good opening. And appreciated by his manager. Nice combination between Wellens and Oakley. And it was not too far beyond. And Powell again, exquisite down the left-hand side. Good ball to Fryett. Still with Fryett. And off the line by Tremarca. Don't underestimate the contribution of Chris Powell here. Another wonderful piece of support play by the 39-year-old. And off the line by Tremarca. And Gessner gets it for Leicester. Fryett to the right. Oakley joining in. Here is Oakley. Cleared. And a stretch by Tremarca. And Oakley looks as though he's winding up a long throw. As Martin Waghorn warms up. Made a big impact as a sub at the weekend. There's trouble here in the area and it's turned into the net. And Gassan's getting the applause. It was very messy in there. And it ended in the back of John Brain's net. It looks as though there might be a foul given here. It's a collision of bodies and tumbles to the floor. And Nguessan with a back heel. The throw caused confusion. And eventually it was turned in. Here's Howard. And guess that. Howard goes for goal and a good save by Crane. It's becoming a bit of a procession now for Leicester City. Howard. It was a free header. And he knows that he ought to have put it on target and I think he believes it too. Adams. Fryett, Macclesfield is stretched here, still with Fryett, good tackle by Ben Sharif, breaks though for Adams, just poked away, a vital moment by Bell, helped on by Wright into the path of Reed, Macclesfield has three in there, now four, Reed goes for goal, there's a deflection, off the underside of the bar, and Wright couldn't turn it goalbound. The nearest Macclesfield have come by some margin this evening. Here's Daniel. Gets round the back, it's a dangerous ball in as well. Headed away by Hobbs. And here's Adams in the chase at the other end, Fryett. Adams in field of him, still with Fryett. Fryett might go, oh, and then he scores! And surely puts the tie out of the reach of Macclesfield Town. 31 goals last season. He now has his first of this. And he will surely put Leicester City into round two of the Carling Cup. Now by Morgan. Tipton. Reed. Finds Hobbs in his way. A thoroughly professional night's work from the Championship side. Nigel Pearson's side never really looked in much danger. No chance of a cup shock here at Moss Rose this evening. It's ended Macclesfield Town 0, Leicester City 2.
It was, I think, a very good performance. I don't think the scoreline really illustrated how well we played, but I think the most important thing tonight was to get through the tie. I thought we passed the ball very well and we were professional.
At the end of the day, it's a good lesson. We didn't capitulate. Yes, they could have scored more goals, but we could also have sneaked one. So it gives us something to build on.
Well, I suppose, Neil, for a promoted side like Leicester, a win in the league followed by a cup win, you couldn't ask for any more than that, could you?
No, Nigel, I've got a lot of time for Nigel. I think he's a level-headed lad as well, and he knows that he played a strong team there, didn't he? So he respected Macclesfield, but it did make it easy. I thought all his big, you know, Howard was such a good pro. And there's no wonder Fryett, you know, it looks like he's back on. He's a goal-scoring goal. It's that type of goal that he's renowned for.
Yeah, I mean, 2 years ago, there were question marks over his levels of fitness.
Yeah.
But I tell you what, this was a cracking goal, wasn't it?
Well, he wouldn't have got that far. 2 years ago, he'd have gone back. He'd have gone back the other way and played a ball square. But here, you can see he's just full of confidence. He's only one thought in his mind when he picks that ball up. He's going to outwit the defender and he's going to get a shot on goal. Nothing else in his mind. And I think the goalie never expected it to come as hard as that, like a blinking missile, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. I suppose for Macclesfield, there's no great shame in losing today.
No, not at all. It's their big game, really. And I think they've got other things, you know, to survive. I think that at the moment with Macclesfield, it's still not an easy place to go.
No.
And so it's a good result, that.
OK. Now, as Neil will testify, it's a long time since the police allowed both Sheffield clubs to kick off on the same day and at the same time. Add in Rotherham playing in at the Don Valley Stadium. And I can tell you, Sheffield was bursting at the seams. Mark Clemmit has been bursting at the seams to tell us all about it.
It may only be round one of the Carling Cup, but Sheffield United against Port Vale, Sheffield Wednesday at home to Rochdale, and Rotherham, of course, playing Sheffield's Don Valley Athletic Stadium, entertaining Derby, all on the same night.
Well, we always risk assess every game, and it involves working with the clubs to sort of get a picture on what's going to happen, what we think is going to happen. Some of that's about criminal intelligence, but some of that's about information that's out there from the clubs. And on this occasion, we felt that this could run on the basis of our risk assessment.
I've got a very tight budget here, and any money that I can get in extra, and this is where the cup competitions come in, then I can obviously then go and strengthen my team, and that's how important it is to me. So I'm putting a team out that I expect to go out there and win the game.
So I'm thinking I might try and watch a bit of both Sheffield clubs tonight, starting here at Hillsborough.
The first leg of the Steel City trilogy went pretty much according to the script. Wednesday simply too good for League Two Rochdale. This 19th-minute volley from Etienne Essayas too good for higher quality opposition. Any thoughts of a Rochdale fight back were dispelled a couple of minutes later. Jermaine Johnson with control and balance to double the home side's advantage. And it was all over 5 minutes into the second half. The Jamaican international spotting Rochdale keeper Kenny Arthur in no man's land for his second of the night to send the blue side of Sheffield home happy.
And 4 miles up the road, here's what was going on at Bramall Lane.
This was well worth the taxi fare, a cup upset in the offing. Mark Richards had League Two Port Vale in front after just 20 minutes, but maybe that was too early to take the lead. It didn't take long for the first doubts to creep in as Billy Sharp found the top corner. Normally, Vale manager Mickey Adams would be cheering United's goals. He's a lifelong Blades supporter, so this was an emotional night. Ian Bennett's howler gifted Richards the winner, a result which had his boss steaming.
Thoroughly embarrassed. I said to the players, tonight, you know, you've got to carry that tonight. You'll be embarrassed, and you should be. We created enough chances to have won by a cricket score. Didn't take any of them. And if you don't want to get hurt in the box, having created the chances, then you don't deserve to win. So, you know, all credit to Port Vale. They hung in there when they needed to. The keeper made 3 or 4 absolutely top-class saves and kept them in the game. And then the two chances that they've had, they've taken. So, you know, I've got to give them credit.
So, success for one half of Sheffield, disappointment for the other. And elsewhere in the city, another one of the shocks of the round.
Last season's semi-finalist Derby County drew first blood and looked to be in for a comfortable night when Lee Croft's pullback enabled Gary Teal to open the scoring on 11 minutes. But perhaps complacency set in, and just before half-time, the hosts were level. Paul Warne with his second goal in as many games for the Millers. And Warne was involved in the winner too, laying off for Kevin Ellison to fire home. A fine come-from-behind victory for the League Two side. Derby boss Nigel Clough big enough to admit that they deserved it.
Great win for Rotherham. Mark Robin's stock continues to rise, doesn't it?
I think they'll win the league. I think they had a good season last year with the points deducted and all that. But I think they've got steady. They've improved the squad. They're going to score goals. And as Nigel will have found out last night, it's not an easy place to go, Don Valley.
It's fair to say you were wincing when you saw Port Vale Beach after
the match. Oh, no, well, I know how it'll have hurt Kevin.
He was seething there, wasn't he?
And I'm sure he said a lot more in the dressing room. And same with, you know, Brian will be pleased there through as well. But it's the City. You know, I think Sheffield United will have expected to have got through easily on that.
What about that opening goal for Sheffield Wednesday? Esaias with that cracking volley, the technique for this.
Well, it's one of those things, isn't it? As a manager, you're on the bench, sometimes you're saying, pass. And then that happens. You think, why don't you do that more often, like? But tremendous technique and, you know, rifles into the net. Lovely to see.
Him and Jermaine Johnson together, that could be quite handy for this
season.
Yeah,
he's scoring for fun as well. So they've got some good players Wednesday this year, and I'm sure they're expecting to be up and around near the playoffs.
You think they'll do it?
No.
No?
You would
say that, of course. Silly question. Right, we'll be bringing you the goals from tonight's other two games. Coventry at home to Hartlepool and Nottingham Forest at home to Bradford a little later. But last night saw 31 first-round matches. So let's bring you up to date with some of those, starting with a couple of matches that saw Championship teams travel to lower league sides. And first up, it's League One Gillingham against Plymouth.
Gillingham's thumping weekend win, 5-0 over Swindon, had the Kent club in the mood for a surprise, and Simeon Jackson continued his flying start to the season. 4 goals in 2 games for the striker, and at least half a dozen scouts from Championship and Premier League clubs there to see it. Andy Barcham increased the duel's lead, capitalising on more of what Plymouth boss Paul Sturrock branded comical defending. The manager's half-time message clearly had some effect. Luke Summerfield's deflected free kick promised an Argyle comeback, but it never materialised.
Shrewsbury and Ipswich served up one of the games of the night, and the visitor's Connor Wickham gave us a glimpse of his huge potential. The 16-year-old Ipswich's youngest ever player hit a brace, including this 11th-minute opener. 2 divisions lower than their rivals, Shrewsbury were far from intimidated, and within 7 minutes they were level, Jake Robinson applying the final touch to a Kevin McIntyre cross. Then on 24 minutes, an early goal of the season candidate. Just look at this from Shrewsbury's Dave Hibbert, shades of the great Matthew Letizia in his prime. Just past the half hour, the Tractor boys were level, Alan Quinn firing in a free kick from the edge of the box. And more to come in the second half, and it's that boy again, Connor Wickham, with his second. The 6'3" teenager clearly out to make a name for himself. But the Shrews weren't finished, and another fine strike to level 16 minutes from time. Shane Cansdell's Sheriff laying down the law with this one. Sadly for Shrewsbury, spot kicks sealed their doom. Misses from Jake Robinson and skipper Graham Coughlan meant Ipswich went through 4-2 on penalties after a night of terrific entertainment.
Yeah, Ipswich taken close there, eventually going through on penalties. But from Mark Simpson's Gillingham, that was a tremendous performance against Plymouth.
Absolutely. We played in pre-season. Although we played at the reserves, they still beat us. And they looked a very strong side, played good football. And another side, you know, you wouldn't want to really be going down there in the next round.
Yeah, we saw a cracking goal earlier from Sheffield Wednesday. What about Dave Hibbert? He's got to take a bow for this strike, surely.
And he meant it as well. You can see that. First thing he does, look up, and in it goes. It's either goes in or it hits the guy at the back of the stand there and knocks him out.
That was another terrific goal.
Super goal. I think there's been some good goals over the last 2 days, I think, in the Cup. And the team seem to be just blossoming, I think. It seems that the Cup seems to be getting from strength to strength at the minute.
Yeah. OK, well, let's take you to a game that took place this evening. It was between Coventry and Hartlepool. A goalless 90 minutes meant Coventry and Poole had to go extra time. And it was Hartlepool who broke the deadlock when Adam Boyd fired them into the lead with a goal from inside the 6-yard box to the bottom right corner of the goal. Hartlepool have made it past this round for the last 6 seasons, and it looks like there's still plenty more to come from them. I mean, what a terrific result that is from them.
Well, you're talking about a club where I won the Player of the Year in 1972, you know, Manish.
Yes, in there. I knew that quite well as well.
So it's a fantastic result for them, and, you know, any success that they can get, they deserve it, and good luck to them. I mean, Chris Turner will be chuffed with his team tonight.
Chris Coleman was complaining, perhaps, that he didn't have enough players on the bench, but you'd think at least that they could turn over a team like Hartlepool.
Well, Crystal still have expected to have won the tie. You know, it's like all the teams in the Championship. You expect to win the tie if you leave three or four out or you have injuries. We had three away yesterday as well ourselves, you know. So you still expect to win, but it's a blow when you don't.
All right, let's round up some of yesterday's other games now.
The same old story for Walsall, who rarely get past the first round. Alex Nicholls' ninth-minute volley had them hoping for a change of fortune after progressing only once in the past 5 years. But a slippery pitch and over-enthusiastic defender proved to be the Saddlers' downfall. Already booked once, Reece Weston's second yellow left the League One club a man down for the best part of an hour. When Accrington Stanley piled on the pressure at the start of the second half, the majority of Walsall's desperate defence ended up camped inside the six-yard box. After they failed to clear their lines, sub Robert Grant found a gap. The League Two players seemed to be coping best with the wet conditions. Sub Sean McConville went close to snatching the winner. Instead, he had to make do with setting up the decisive goal, providing a perfect cross for Paul Mullin, just as the match seemed destined for extra time.
Watford needed extra time to break Barnett's resistance at Underhill. Joby Mackenough with the free kick and defender Mike Williamson powering home a far post header to break the deadlock. And deep into stoppage time, the Championship side finally ensured their passage into the second round. Scott Severin leaving Barnett keeper Jake Cole with a red face. This one eventually went with the form book.
Stand by for Steve Cabber's early bid for goal of the season. The former Sheffield United and Watford striker clearly keen to make an impression with his new club. A terrific run had Bristol City's defence in tatters, calm and composed around the keeper, and oh dear, a let-off for the Championship club. But the referee wasn't so forgiving. Danny Haynes unwise to clip the ankles of Ryan Dixon when he'd already been booked. City faced the final half hour with 10 men. Even so, it was Gary Johnson's side who broke the deadlock. Liam Fontaine's improvisation set up Nicky Maynard. Otherwise, the star of the show was City keeper Dean Gherkin, who made a string of outstanding saves and probably deserved his luck in the dying seconds. Sam Saunders hitting the bar not once, but twice.
A game of three penalties at the Memorial Ground. The first going the home side's way just past the half-hour mark when Chris Lyne's surging run was halted by Adam Hinshelwood. Darrell Duffy sending Clark Masters the wrong way from the spot. Rovers doubled their lead on 58 minutes when Joe Kafur was sent sprawling in the box, once more by the luckless Hinshelwood. Duffy was again entrusted with the spot kick, but although Masters guessed correctly this time, the Scotsman slotted home at the second attempt. But Aldershot were handed a lifeline 2 minutes later when David Pike inexplicably threw up a hand for reasons only he can explain. Marvin Morgan made no mistake from the spot, but Rovers held on to continue their progress.
Bury's rock-solid home record last season, 14 wins at Gig Lane, has rapidly unravelled. A touch of glamour about the arrival of West Brom, who so recently said goodbye to the top flight. The golfing quality was obvious. Paul Scott's poor touch costly as Graham Doran swept the Baggies into a fifth-minute lead. Roberto Di Matteo's men continued to dominate, playing the attractive passing game that became their trademark under Tony Mowbray. Michael Jones's own goal meant the contest was all but over and still less than half an hour gone. Rough luck for a player who'd just run the length of the pitch, attempting to snuff out the danger. Bury did improve in the second half, and Efe Soje seemed to have put them back in contention. The linesman's flag spoiled the fun.
Cardiff survived a late scare to see off plucky Dagenham and Redbridge, but there was little sign of the nail-biting to come when Gavin Ray put the home side ahead on 20 minutes with a fine strike. 6 minutes later, though, controversy. Jay Bothroyd fouled in the box by Dagenham's Will Antwi, whose argument that he won the ball fell on deaf ears. Bothroyd's weak effort was easily saved by Tony Roberts. However, the referee's assistant spotted something he didn't like, so Bothroyd was granted another chance, and this time did rather better. The Daggers gave their hosts a torrid time in the second half, and with 9 minutes left, substitute Josh Scott gave them real hope. But those hopes were dashed in stoppage time, as Peter Whittingham applied the finish to an impressive move to see Cardiff a little nervously safely through to round two.
We make it difficult for ourselves because we should have scored more goals. Just sloppy play from us, sloppy pass. And you know, they're the things that we've had a go at them for. But they've had a hard game on Saturday and then come again today. And so it was nice to win. But yeah, you're always looking for perfection sometimes. And we were a bit disappointed in the way we'd moved the ball. But every time we did move the ball quickly, we created chances, and that's how the goals came.
An all-League One battle at Brunton Park, every bit as tight as you'd expect. Richard Keogh close in the first half to edging Carlisle in front, but the teams were eventually separated a minute from time. David Raven's cross, just right for Scott Doby.
Cheltenham took the lead against their League One opponents when a long throw had Southend's defence all shook up, and Elvis Hammond was on hand to turn the ball home. But Lee Barnard turned the game round with two goals in the final 13 minutes. First, the former Tottenham striker levelled matters with a close-range header. Then, with just 2 minutes left on the clock, Barnard was again the man in the right place at the right time to nod home a Simon Francis cross, the Shrimpers safely through.
Yeah, we're just watching over those goals. Watford, obviously, well, teetering maybe an extra time, just about got through, but you were just saying to me it was the Accrington result over Walsall that's
well,
all right.
It's just clubs, you know, they have lows, don't they? And they've really been at the bottom, and everybody tips them to get relegated this year.
Yeah.
So it's a fantastic night for them, you know, tonight, to get two goals like that. A little, man sent off, but they still need to get, you know, and I think the crowd will have loved it, won't it? Apart from being, you know, an advertisement, it's nice to see them winning a game.
Not quite a fantastic night for your former Sheffield United player, Steve Cabba, for Brentford.
No, you can say that, you know, and yes, you can... How many people would have got that far? Like, he took 30 yards inside his own half. He's made a great run. And then he's done everything right, and then he just slips on his back, on his foot, as he's just taken in. I mean, yeah, it's a miss, and you can pick on that. But I think you look at the positives, he's done a fantastic run there. Stephen, by the way, not Steve. He always tells me off for calling
Stephen Cabba. We stand corrected. So if you're Andy Scott, what would you be saying to him? Just keep your head up.
Andy, hey, they've got...
The players would no doubt...
And they're another good side, Brentford, make no mistake. You know, so I think it's a good... You know, there's a few in that team. I think every division is exciting this year.
Yeah,
I think it's wide open.
Yeah. Right, let's have a look now at some more action from yesterday, starting at Gresty Road.
Blackpool rested seven players, but the Championship team still managed to ease past Crewe. Adam Nolan's back with his first club after 8 years away, quickly winning some new admirers. That was tough on the League Two side, who'd been giving as good as they got, and had the result back in the balance with 17 minutes to go. Calvin Zola's goal seemed set to make it an anxious finale for Ian Holloway's team, but Blackpool had an extra gear. Ishmael de Montagnac's pacey, powerful run was crowned by the perfect through pass for Daniel Nardiello. Tucked away first time for a win which justified Holloway's decision to shuffle the pack and take a look at his squad.
Luck hasn't been on Exeter's side so far this season. Beaten by two goals from Leeds' prolific Jermaine Beckford on Saturday, they came up against another front man in form last night. Wayne Routledge putting QPR in front on 53 minutes, and 7 minutes later the same player making it two after Patrick Adjumang's teasing run set him up perfectly. Exeter had held firm in an even first half, but things were now going horribly wrong. Scott Goldbourne was sent off for handling Kasper Gorks's header on the line. No real arguments about this decision, and that allowed Routledge to complete a 13-minute hat-trick from the spot and effectively ended as a contest. As the 10 men visibly tired, Rangers were able to put even more gloss on the scoreline. With 5 minutes remaining, new Italian signing Alessandro Pellicori scored his first goal for the club. and the best might have been saved for last. Hogan Ephraim with a delightful curler. Tough this on the Grecians, easy in the end for Rangers.
League Two against League One at Edgar Street, and the underdogs in trouble midway through the second half. Richard Rose couldn't get a grip on Andy Gray, and even trying proved costly. The striker handed the chance to put Charlton in front. A fantastic stop by Adam Bartlett saved Hereford, who took the match to extra time and clinched their upset 8 minutes in. Johnny Godsmark managed to get goal side of Grant Basie, and the lad on loan from Newcastle had made his own little piece of Hereford history.
It may not take Huddersfield fans too long to get over the loss of Andy Booth. Former Ipswich Town striker Jordan Rhodes looks a real bargain at £150,000. He hit the target twice in this victory over Stockport to add to the late equaliser he scored away at Southend in the league on Saturday. On this form, the 19-year-old is in for an exceptional season. County were never really in it after those goals either side of half-time, and they were well and truly finished once Theo Robinson added a third 16 minutes from the end with a confident finish. Manager Lee Clark clearly has the Terriers playing his brand of football. The only blemish on an otherwise impressive night came too late to do any damage. Just a couple of minutes remained when Adam Griffin thumped home a late consolation for County, but it was Huddersfield, especially their young striker, who caught the eye.
League 2 Lincoln held out for 71 minutes against their championship opponents, only for one of their outstanding performers to make the mistake which swung the tie. Janos Kovac robbed by Daniel Bogdanovic, and Barnsley were safely through to the second round.
Millwall made short work of their tie with Bournemouth at the New Den. Chris Hackett's powerful run set up Gary Alexander to open the scoring with his superb volley just after the half hour. Then Millwall cult hero Neil Harris took the match over. Harris had never scored for the Lions in the League Cup, but he made up for lost time with a hat-trick, his first coming at the far post 5 minutes before the break. The Lions' all-time top scorer then combined with Alexander to put Millwall 3 up on 68 minutes. And he left the best till last. This was the finish of a striker full of confidence and self-belief. His sixth career hat-trick good enough to send Millwall into round two.
After conceding five on Saturday, Swindon Town dished out a hiding themselves. Off to a glorious start when John Paul McGovern brilliantly embarrassed keeper Willie Guerrey. MK Dons cancelled out the advantage shortly after the break when Lewis Goban was caught off balance by a shove in the back. The cue for Jermaine Easter's first goal since signing from Plymouth. That was a full storm for Paul Ince's team. Danny Wilson had urged his players to regain their self-respect after the humbling at Gillingham, and Billy Painter had them back on track to do just that. Not much chance for Guerrey that time, but fingers pointed at the Frenchman once more as he made a dreadful hash of catching Anthony McNamee's cross. Painter claimed his second of the night, at least sparing the keeper the humiliation of an own goal. If only David McCracken could say the same. The rout complete just 2 minutes later as another centre caused chaos. Lloyd Macklin's delivery this time. McCracken's intervention probably denied Painter a hat-trick, but he'll have loved the scoreline all the same.
They might be separated by two divisions, but there was little to choose between Notts County and Doncaster on the night. It could have gone either way, but James Coppinger's fine effort on 54 minutes, Doncaster's first shot on target, incidentally, was enough to settle things in favour of the Championship side.
League new boys Torquay kept Crystal Palace on tenterhooks for the first 65 minutes, their dogged resistance finally broken by Darren Ambrose. It would be a successful night for the midfielder, signed on a free from Charlton in the summer, but not without a scare along the way. Tim Sills sent 400 travelling fans delirious with the equaliser. They had next to no time to savour that feeling. Almost immediately, Palace launched a high ball into the box that had Chris Todd wrestling with Alassane Ndiaye, and the referee's mind was made up. Ambrose on the spot for his second. Powerfully dispatched to end the Championship club's concerns.
Well, Neil, as you mentioned at the top of the programme, happy with that performance and led by your new signing, Darren Ambrose.
Yeah, he's been injured for a couple of weeks, so he's a little bit short, but last night his quality shone through, really. He should have scored a few more as well, but it was a good, you know, overall good result.
So how are you finding things at Palace? So, coming up to your two-year anniversary in October, isn't it?
Yeah, that's
right.
Is
there still a transfer embargo at Sellers?
Yes, there is, yeah. But Chairman's working out, he's working ever so hard. We've all had problems, and you know, he keeps putting his money in, and he's still trying to sell the club.
Yeah.
But, you know, we'll overcome that.
Is he still looking to sell the club, Simon Jordan?
Yeah, he's still trying to sell it. But it's a difficult time with the financial situation at the moment, so we just have to muck on and, you know, get what we can, and I'm sure we'll be all right. It's just, like you say, you've just got to grit your teeth at times.
But you have been blessed with some talented youngsters at Palace, haven't you? I mean, Scannell, Nathaniel Klein, Freddie Sears, you got in from West Ham, too.
Yeah, Victor Moses. We've got four or five really good, you know, young teenagers. And I think that's been a blessing. And it's brought the older players, you know, your Clint Hills and Sean Derry and a couple of more. It's given them a new lease of life. You know, they're almost babysitting them, I think, some of these lads.
But
it's
that met you grandad.
Yeah, I know, me grandad a lot of them. Although I do look younger than some of my players.
All right, well, just in case you ever doubted that football was a funny old game, then bear in mind what happened in Norwich and Colchester on Saturday. Colchester, of course, went to Carrow Road and won 7-1, but just 3 days later, this is what happened to both teams in the League Cup.
Norwich manager Brian Gunn made five changes to the team embarrassed by Colchester at the weekend. Fullback Adam Drury retained his place and won the penalty on 55 minutes, from which Wes Houlihan scored the opening goal. ...17-year-old Tom Adeyemi was handed a place in the Norwich starting lineup and made a strong case to keep it after an impressive midfield performance. He started the move, which Grant Holt finished in some style. Much is expected of Holt, the Canaries' biggest summer signing, and he lived up to it here. His work rate has led to him being nicknamed the Horse by his teammates, and when Adeyemi's shot was saved, no prizes for guessing who was on hand to clean up the mess. This particular horse looks like a thoroughbred, and he completed his hat-trick in stoppage time. Immediate rehabilitation for Norwich. No doubt the fans who threw their season tickets at Brian Gunn probably feel a little foolish right now.
You know, we asked for togetherness and unity. You know, we didn't harp back on Saturday too much. I mean, it was obviously disappointing, but at the same time, you know, the response is what we asked for, and we got that, and obviously we're all delighted in the dressing room.
A classic case of after the Lord Mayor's show for Colchester, brought down to earth after just 90 seconds. Orient's Adrian Pachulea netting on his debut. That 7-1 sensation at Carrow Road was always going to be hard to follow, and midway through the second half, the Londoners were in full command. JJ Melligan on target. Orient manager Geraint Williams spent 2 years in charge at Colchester, and this was a very happy return. The home side had striker Clive Platt sent off in stoppage time, and Simon Hackney's free kick was little consolation. The warm glow from the weekend had rapidly worn off.
Right, before we bring you the best of tonight's other ties, here's the rest of last night's action.
Morecambe might have had hopes of an upset in the All-Lancashire clash at Deepdale. Ian Craney fouled by Preston keeper Andy Lonergan on the half-hour for a penalty. But villain quickly became hero, Lonergan saving Mark Duffy's spot kick, and Morecambe's chance had gone. 3 minutes later, the Championship side were ahead. Chris Brown with the far post header. There might be something about crosses that Sammy McElroy's shrimps don't like. Just before half-time, another cross, another headed goal. Stephen Elliott with this one.
And that theme continued after the break. Another cross, another header. Although Barry Nicholson was made to stoop to conquer for Preston's third. A corner produced yet another unchallenged header. Neil Trotman enjoying that one as Preston continued with their target practice. Neil Mellor added a fifth in stoppage time. Another cross doing the damage. Mellor given time and space to finish the job. Consolation for Morecambe with Michael Twiss getting the better of Liam Chilvers, but no prizes for guessing what Sammy McElroy will be working on at the training ground this week.
A trip to the plush Medeski Stadium, an exciting prospect for the league's newest club, but Burton Albion's hopes of success disappeared inside the first 9 minutes. Irish striker Dave Mooney defied the tight angle to mark his debut with a sixth-minute opener. And almost immediately after the restart, teenager Nicholas Bignall turned up the turbo boost to make the most of Marek Matejowski's pass. With the clock still in single figures, 2-0 became 3-0, one of the more forgettable moments in Kevin Poole's long career. The 46-year-old Burton keeper caught way out of position, allowing Bignall to slot his second of the night. Entertaining fare for the home supporters at least, and now Reading fancied their chances from anywhere. Gylfi Sigurdsson relished the freedom to try his luck with the match all but won already, and the Icelandic midfielder came up with something special. Burton did pull one back after the break. With the help of a deflection, Jimmy Phillips notched their sole contribution to the score sheet. But Reading will be in high spirits as they head to Newcastle for their league meeting at the weekend. The four-goal advantage restored, as sub Noel Hunt's strike was parried into the path of Mooney.
This one went with the form book. Although it was Route 1 stuff for Scunthorpe's opening goal, Cliff Burns' long punt forward fell to the feet of Gary Hooper, and his 12th minute cross was buried by Matt Sparrow at the far post. The Championship club doubled their lead 9 minutes after the interval. Michael O'Connor's free kick was saved by Spyrites keeper Tommy Lee, but Paul Hayes was on hand to pick up the pieces. Chesterfield gave themselves brief hope by pulling a goal back with 19 minutes remaining. Rob Jones clumsily brought down Drew Talbot in the penalty area. And Darren Curry dispatched the spot kick, but that was as close as Chesterfield would come.
Ricky Lambert wasted no time introducing himself at St Mary's. Southampton's new signing from Bristol Rovers showed why Saints were prepared to shell out more than a million. At this level, Lambert guarantees goals. League 2 Northampton felt finishing was the difference between the sides. Their fate sealed as Adam Lallana extended the lead, though it was the new man who took the limelight.
Managed to get Ricky Lambert in time, just in time for the game. And he had an excellent performance, and the team was strong behind him, and I thought we were deserved winners tonight.
Swansea are still adjusting to the loss of management and players to Wigan Athletic, so this comfortable victory over Brighton was just what they wanted. Skipper Gary Monk with the first goal after 17 minutes to settle any early nerves. With last season's top scorer Jason Scotland joining the Exodus North, the Swans hope a real Scot, Stephen Dobby, can fill his boots. And the striker recruited from Queen of the South began to do just that with a brace. First, reacting quickest to make it 2-0 on the hour. And then, completing the scoring with a confident lob and tap-in deep into stoppage time. Easy on the night for the Welsh side, but sterner opposition in the Championship will test how they're reacting to life under new management.
Two players who score 40 goals, they're gone. And everything we need to time when we build something new with different players, everything he needs time for that. We can't be the worst team when we lose and the best team when we win. We make good things, good steps today, but we have a lot to improve.
Clemmit or Grimsby apart, ruthlessly exploiting the League Two club's defensive frailties. Unmarked, Paul McLaren got Rovers going just past the half hour, and after some sloppy marking from a throw, Joe Widdowson upended Craig Curran just 5 minutes later. A chance for Ian Thomas-Moore's first goal in his new guise. He used to be just Ian Moore, of course, before getting married in the summer. The contest was all but over by the break. Curran able to take the plaudits himself this time when he was left all alone in the centre. A first victory on the cards for new manager John Barnes, who wasn't as happy with his team's second half performance, even though they added a fourth. Gareth Edds wrapped up a comprehensive victory.
Darren Ferguson's side recovered from losing their opening league match at Derby to sail past Wickham. Aaron McLean was on hand to open his account for the season in the 24th minute from the tightest of angles. Peterborough added a second 9 minutes later. Tommy Williams with the teasing cross and Tommy Rowe providing the finish for his first goal for the club. By now, Posh were in cruise control and George Boyd added a spectacular third with the goal of the match. A thumping 25-yard dipping effort which gave Wickham keeper Jamie Young no chance. And there was more to come, as another flowing Posh move resulted in former Lincoln midfielder Lee Frecklington crashing home a superb 68th-minute strike.
So first win of the season for Peterborough, but for John Barnes at Tranmere, and then, of course, for Brendan Rodgers at Reading, it's good to get off to their first win of the season.
Absolutely. I'm not bothered what it is. I bet they've all played strong sides tonight, you know, and they'll all be a lot happier tonight, because it's nice to see goals go in and get a win under your belt.
Yeah, it's interesting for John Barnes at Tranmere, isn't it? Because he's got Ronnie Moore, his Ronnie Moore's son there, and Ian Thomas Moore, I think they call him.
That's
now.
Right, yeah.
And he scored for them, so at least it doesn't hold anything about against Barnes.
Well, I said he's probably happy his old man's gone. Anything to go by.
And what about Ricky Lambert for Southampton? I mean, that deal went through very quickly. There's going to be a few goals in him in League One.
Well, absolutely. I mean, £1 million. You know, Alan, if he's got the money, good luck to him. I think it's great. And probably I'll look on from an envious position.
Yeah.
But he's renowned in that level, isn't he, Ricky, to score goals. And Southampton need goals, so it's a great signing.
All right, well, there's just two matches left to finish off our Carling Cup first round-up. Starting with Bradford City's match at Nottingham Forest. All the goals coming in the second half in this one. Less than a minute after the restart, Nathan Tyson found Paul Anderson, who rose inside the area to head home Forest first. Nathan Tyson was at the centre of everything Forest that did well, and he was on hand again to set up Dexter Blackstock, who doubled Forest's advantage. And it was all over as a contest, 9 minutes from time, when Lewis McGugan grabbed a third after approach work from Paul Anderson. McGugan found in the middle of the goal. His low shot gave Simon Eastwood no chance in the Bradford goal. That's eight goals, by the way, Bradford have shipped in their first two games of the season. It got worse for them. Jonathan Bateson saw red for this foul on that man, Nathan Tyson. What do you think here, Neil?
I think that a lot of the Forest players looking at it didn't play Saturday. They've got things to prove. That was a sending off, yeah. I don't think Stuart will complain about that. But I think they've got a lot of players playing for the place.
Well, here's what happened a little earlier at the Ricoh Arena. Just a recap, a goalless 90 minutes meant Coventry and Hartlepool had to go to extra time. It was Hartlepool who broke the deadlock when Adam Boyd fired them into the lead with a goal from inside the six-yard box through to the bottom right corner of the goal. Hartlepool have made it past this round for the last six seasons, and this shock continued their run, of course. Right, well, the draw has been made just under 2 hours ago. Let's have a look for the second round of the Carling Cup, and some pretty tasty ties on their way, no less, or not least, West Ham v Millwall, Cardiff versus Bristol Rovers, Forest are taking on Middlesbrough, Doncaster against Spurs, Newcastle Huddersfield, Crystal Palace, your team, Neil, up against Manchester City.
That is an absolutely fantastic... I think that's the best draw in the whole lot for me. Because, you know, everybody wants to see all the money players that they've signed, don't they, Mark? You know, Mark Hughes, the thoughts of the team. I'm just smiling to myself thinking about those top-class players walking down to the dressing room, down the tunnel, everybody that knows the scruffiest tunnel, well, not the scruffiest, but the dampest place there is,
yeah.
The worst place to get to. It'll be interesting to see them that night.
So, do you have nerves when you know the likes of Tevez, Adebayor, Colo Torre are coming?
No, I think all the nerves will be in their dressing room. I think Mark knows it'll not be an easy place to come. They should beat us on a good night, but, you know, Sellers Park, it's got some great atmosphere at night matches, cup matches. It'll be a great crowd, which is what we want.
Yeah.
And we've got two or three players that could play in their team, so it'll be interesting.
If you're going to go all the way, or at least some way, you're going to have to do it the hard way.
We've got to beat them, haven't we, if we get to the final. I said to the players last night that.
Yeah. OK, well, that's it. 50 minutes and well over 100 goals. Neil, thanks very much indeed. All the very best at Bristol City. At the weekend. I'll be back with Steve Claridge on Saturday evening for the Football League show here on BBC One. We kick off at 11:20, straight after Match of the Day. And, of course, plenty of goals, plenty of drama, plenty of shocks. That's what cup football is all about. From Neil and from me, good night.